introduction, and I'm so glad to see so many of my friends here. But I think you will realize that this is something that I'm pretty passionate about, and it's so good that I have this opportunity to speak to all of you about it. This is because Living Wills Advanced Care Planning, and I'll speak about this a little further, is something that the rest of the world has been doing for 50 years. Why have we been left so far behind? Anyway, so let me begin. I'm just going to put a pointer on because I'll need it intermittently and then go on. Now, I don't know if any of you saw this news item. This came a little while ago, 2018. And there was this elderly couple in Mumbai who don't have kids. And they told the president that, they wrote to the president, prime minister, everybody, saying that, come and kill us. Which is basically, rather than taking charge, making decisions, planning, they want a commando team to come and take them up to heaven immediately. I don't think that is appropriate. And I think for all of us, it's important, as Sudhaji said, this is a painful conversation, a painful process, thought process. But all of us have to do it. If you don't want to do it, be very clear about it, that you don't want to do it. But don't say, I didn't think about it, and so on. So we'll come to this. Why is this so important? Look at this bar graph. If you look at the bar graph, you'll see that in India, only about 5% of us live alone. And we are still, for those of you here, most of you will have younger generations to look after you. But look at other countries. For instance, at the top is Norway or any of the Western countries. It goes into 35%. But look below that. If you look at China, we are 5%, they are 15%. And South Korea is already 25%. So as we urbanize, as we become a richer country, hopefully, once COVID is over, things will restart. But we will have to plan for this. And why is this so important? This is a haunting picture from Japan. This was a huge apartment complex that was built in the 50s. And when you look at the original article, you'll see those pictures of families, young families, kids playing, all that. And then Japan became an older society. And the young people dwindled. And there were only old people left there. And now, very often, in this huge apartment complex, they find out that somebody has passed away only when the smell wants them. We don't want to go there. Then what about people who are in the LGBT community? They may be estranged from family. So they need this kind of decision making to be done. But more importantly, whenever anybody is asked across the world, think about it. Where do you want to pass your last days, weeks? Everybody says, in my own bed. But in reality, 70 to 80% actually die in hospital. And the biggest worry is that the death is not going to be peaceful. Like Woody Allen said, I'm not afraid of death. I just don't want to be there when it happens. So there is pain and suffering. And to prevent that, there is a very simple instrument. As I said, the rest of the world has been aware of it and has been doing it for the past 50 years. This is a living will. This is a basic form. I will show you where it is available. And you can just download it and fill it up. And then we will talk a little further about it. But essentially, you have to begin thinking of this as the last journey of your life. So this journey or this illness experience, what do you want it to be like? So for that, we need to know how people die. And this is from a research paper that came out almost about 20 years ago, which looked at how people actually die. So the first, everybody thinks sudden death. That somewhere when everything is over and done with and I have sorted out everything, one day I will go to bed and next morning I will wake up in heaven. Not going to happen. There are very few people who get that, and you have to do a lot of punya to get it. I suppose you recognize him. he actually literally died that way, literally while he was lecturing. But in reality, after the age of 50 years, less than 10% of people die suddenly. Less than 10%, typically 7%. This is because all the risky things that people do, smoking, driving motorcycles, all that is over by the time you're 50 years old. And you're more mature and sensible. So how do people die? Well, one route is typically in the when you are in the 60s, late 50s, 60s, cancer peaks at that time. And in cancer, once chemotherapy has been given and maybe has failed, second chemotherapy comes up, or sometimes right in the beginning, people are okay till a very till a certain stage, and then the cancer goes out of control. We call this the Niagara Falls trajectory. Once it falls, begins to fall, it will go down. And this accounts for about 20% of all deaths. I suppose you recognize this picture, Mr. Manohar Parikar, the CM of Goa. The next is organ failure. Typically, people who have bad diabetes, hypertension, various problems, their lungs, hearts, kidneys start to give way. And these people have what we call a looping trajectory. They become ill, come into hospital, come out, not as well as before, then go in again, then come out again, and this goes on. So we call it a looping trajectory. And for this, I don't have a VIP's picture because VIPs usually get organ transplants, the common man does. But the one trajectory that 50% of us are going to get is called the frailty trajectory, which means that we come into our late 70s, early 80s, as it is at a somewhat low level of function, and things go on dwindling down, down, down. And this becomes a fairly long, and in some ways also, some people have are very productive at this age, but for many it's a painful trajectory. I suppose you recognize Atal Bihari Vajpayee. He passed away after almost 15 years of illness at home. So this is a long one. And then you have this catastrophic event trajectory in which somebody who's otherwise doing well, usually somebody who's in the older age group, somebody who's very fit, late 70s, early 80s, gets a bad hip fracture and never is the same again. In fact, they keep going downhill. I mean, dwindling down immediately after that. So that's one more trajectory that has been recognized. What does all of this mean? If you take out the sudden death pattern, then for 85 to 90% of us, death is predictable. Definitely some weeks and usually some months before it occurs. In some people, you can make a better than 50% guess that next year they will not be there. And yet, some of you may read Hindi. I'll just read this out to you. In English, it says, birth and death have both become expensive. You're not born without a caesarean and you cannot die without a ventilator. Think about that. This picture is not from India. This came on Twitter and I immediately copied it down. This was a family. This photo has been taken by the grandson. His sons, his wife are all there. They are all having a beer together on the day before he passed away. This is a little difficult to imagine in India. And we have now realized that India, in fact, gives a very bad quality of death. This was estimated on multiple parameters. When it was first done in 2010, we were the bottom of 40 large countries. In 2015, we improved a little bit because they found 13 countries that were worse than us. And fortunately, both China and Pakistan were worse than us. So we could be happy about that. And there are three major problems with the way we look at death. We are not willing to talk about death. And you know what happens when people do not talk about death or do not know that it is approaching? They lose an opportunity for last wishes. We know that if people have to be at peace in the last days, they have to do what is called a life review. They have to settle their accounts, forgive, ask for forgiveness. You know, all those things that must be said openly. If that is not done, people are not at peace. The second is, but for that you need to know about it. The second is, our laws do not permit patients and families to take charge. And doctors are worried about making decisions because they think somebody is going to come and sue them. Legal system is worried about misuse because they think everybody except the judges are corrupt. So the default option is to continue till the literally the bitter end, which is why people die on ventilators. And then my colleague in palliative care who's listening knows this, that we have palliative care as a system is not really easily available. Better in the big cities, but it's difficult to get. And a lot of the shortage of morphine as well as professional who can address pain. And this Sudhaji also said that we are not, why are we not willing to talk about that? This is a question that was posed by the Yaksh to Yudhishthir at the time in the Mahabharata itself. The Yaksh asked, one of the questions was, what is the greatest wonder? And Yudhishthir said, day after day, countless creatures reach Yama, that yet those that remain behind think of themselves as immortal. And that has not changed. So think of the last journey of your life. Sorry, just give me a minute. I need to do something because, yes. Think of the last journey of your life. As I said, the last illness, who has the information, who is planning, and whose responsibility is it to plan? So let's consider this. Now, information, well, foreseeing and foretelling has always been the doctor's responsibility, correct? But I am a doctor, and I know that when patients ask me to be honest with them, they also expect me to be optimistic. They also expect me to be accurate and honest. Of course, some families say, don't tell. But typically, patients say, tell with all these. Now, this is a little difficult to do. And you need to be trained in putting these three things together. To be honest, to be accurate, and yet to be optimistic. So, because we are not trained in it, usko mat batao in Hindi means, don't tell her or don't tell him. This is rubbish that we all accept. Because we doctors are not trained in how to do this. And on the flip side, patients, family, community, everybody needs to understand. Honesty is really the best policy. Because when this information is hidden, it worsens depression. It worsens anxiety. Because a person who's ill knows things are not going right. And are pretending, no, everything will be well, is concealment and collusion. It only makes the situation worse. So till we reach the stage that doctors are willing to tell and their patients, actually not the patients, their families are willing to hear, well, unfortunately, the policy is don't ask and don't tell, which obviously is not a very good policy. So remember that the destination cannot be changed, but decisions can be taken about what the journey should be like, and it needs you to be aware and to take charge. Now, I believe that a good death happens when the person knows when death is coming and understands what can be expected, so that she has the time to say goodbye, preferably control the timing, be able to leave when it is time to go, and not have life prolonged. So that that person has control and choice over where death occurs and in whose presence. And this happens when they can issue advance directives, that is a living will, so that your wishes are respected. And you have access to spiritual and emotional support and hospice care so that you go through that last trajectory, maybe not completely free from suffering, but as little suffering as we can make. And please understand, palliative care can do a lot. So it begins with understanding who is planning your last journey. Are you planning it? Or at least, are you handing it to someone you trust? Because if you go to default mode, nobody plans. That is the worst. The worst suffering happens when there is nobody able or willing to make decisions. Because if we have some planning, then suffering can be minimized. Now, if you are conscious, if you can speak, then throughout all this, your choices and decisions come first. So nobody can put you into an ICU. Nobody can put you on a ventilator if you are able to speak and say, I don't want this. The problem is that deciding right till the end is actually only a minority of people. Most of us will lose what is called decision-making capacity. If our minds are clear, we may not be able to speak. So once the what is called the dying process begins, which is about a week or 10 days before actual death. In cancer, this happens typically weeks before the actual death. In people who have organ failure, which means they have, heart failure or kidney failure. Whenever they go into the crisis, they lose it. When they come out, they're better. And you can understand, they go in and out. But people who have neurodegenerative illnesses, where the brain is deteriorating, can lose it quite early. Sometimes even as early as 10 years before death. So you can understand, in that situation, you have to make these decisions very, very early, right in the beginning. Does that mean that you will lose control in the end? No, not if you plan for it. And this is the living will. Now, living will is the term that was first put out in the late 1960s, early 1970s. And then people made the term advanced medical directives, and I'll explain you that. But now we call the whole process advanced care planning. So the first decision that you have to take, I think you will have understood, is I decide who decides, or then I take suffering by default because there is no decision or discussion. So how do people normally do this? You can look yourself and see which of these roles fits you. Are you the kind of person who says, I decide? Maybe you are an autonomist and you will take all decisions for your life and you will not leave it to anybody else. Or you may be an altruist. You don't want to give anybody trouble. And again, it becomes important to make these decisions so that nobody else has the burden of those decisions, as Sudhaji did. But it is also okay. Let me point out that whenever I check in live audiences, the autonomists are roughly about 30 to 40% of people. About another 30 or 40% would like others to decide. And this others deciding can be an authorizer who actually says, so and so will decide. So these three roles are the ones that we should all fit into. At least you transfer that authority by explicit. Otherwise, you say, I trust my son, my eldest son, my daughter, whoever it is to make these decisions. But even there, it is important to talk to them. Because you may think they understand you. But unless this conversation is had, nobody knows. And an avoider is somebody who says, God will decide. But that becomes a little troublesome. So if possible, think of three people who can accept this responsibility and are available, which means that when you reach the hospital, they will come. Put them in sequence. First decision maker, second decision maker, third decision maker. Obviously, if the son who does all the taking care of you, makes all the decisions, is in the US, then you can't put him as first decision maker, but he should be at least third. The other thing is that this is not a committee. They don't take a vote. Because if they do that, then you will never have a decision. They can talk to each other, but only one person decides. So in that sequence, if the first one is not available, then the second one takes the decision. The second is not available, the third takes a decision. Generally, this does work. And then you fill in this document. Now, we have made this fairly simple document for Indian purposes. Abroad or on websites, you will see fairly large, elaborate documents. But right now, I think if we start using this, this is good enough. So these are the situations that you will think of. If you reach the stage of terminal illness and go into coma with no reasonable expectation of regaining consciousness, or have a disease state from which there is no reasonable expectation of recovering with acceptable quality of life, or reach a persistent vegetative state, I request that a panel of three doctors of adequate expertise and experience should confirm this. And if all these situations are confirmed, then these life-sustaining treatments should be removed. And what are these life-sustaining treatments? It's even IV fluids. It's even artificial feeding by the rice tube, the tube feeds. Dialysis and artificial ventilator, we all understand. Chemotherapy, CPR, all of this we understand. But it is actually all of these, and it is your choice. If you want, you can tick all of them or whatever. I mean, but it's important to think this through. Now, when you appoint those surrogate decision makers, those three people that you have done, they have the responsibility of securing compliance, making sure that the doctors follow what you have said. And you may give them discretion to do this, or you may actually say, no, they have no discretion. You will do what I have said. That's it. All that I'm appointing you is to make sure that that is done. And obviously, as I said, you will have these 1, 2, 3 following this. And even, and if you are conscious, it is the responsibility of the doctor. If you're conscious, you're able to communicate, it is the responsibility of the doctor to ask you, this was your living will. Do you want to go with it? And you have the right, even at the last minute, of saying, no, cancel it. And that I want all full treatment, and it will be revoked immediately. So it can be revoked orally, but has to be written. Now, this document is available on multiple websites, and anybody who wants it is welcome to put it up. It's free for everybody. It was originally framed by Dr. Rajgopal of Pallium India, but we have elaborated it further, working with Vidhi Legal Policy. It is also, in a sense, a kind of a document which is supported by the Indian Association of Palliative Care. Now, this has to be signed by 2 witnesses. Obviously, those witnesses, at least one of those witnesses should be from outside. I mean, the people who are your surrogate decision makers, you can't have number one and number two both signing as witnesses. At least one witness should be from outside. That witness should preferably not be connected with your estate will, meaning should not be benefiting from your passing away and so on. There are precautions. We can discuss that whenever needed. And it has to be signed before an appropriate authority. And I will come to that a little later. As part of this, you need to make a decision about the location of care. Now, frankly, let me assure you, no intensivist, means ICU doctor that I know of, wants to die in his own ICU. Why? An ICU is a horrible place to die. The lights are on constantly. There is constant noise. And you're not fully conscious, and there are strange masked people doing all kinds of painful things to you. No. But if you want acute care, which means emergency care, then it usually means the ICU. Unless there are clear instructions given that, yes, this is a situation we may not be able to manage well at home. We will go to the hospital, but we will not go to the ICU. And this is something that you can actually decide towards the end also. What we don't have are extended care facilities for assisted living. We do have hospices. There's a very famous one called Karunashra in Bangalore, but it is restricted only for cancer. And I know this is true of almost all, except a new one that I'm associated with, which has been set up in Goa. And we hope that this is a wider movement. But for most people prefer home. And we should be able to support them. Palliative care should be able to support them to pass away at home. Now, the living will is just a document. A process and a system is needed to make it effective. If you look at medical technology, Chennai is the country's leader, including the Mohan Foundation is represented here, on liver transplants. And we have been doing it for decades now. So that kind of medical technology has been entering India literally 1 to 2 years after it is invented. Why not this? Because, frankly, the people who need it, the people who benefit from it, are the common citizens. And if you look at government, if you look at authorities, basically the authorities' attitude is, we don't want this additional headache. Doctors, we don't know how to talk about this, and we don't want this headache. Again, the same thing. So this is something that will have to be led by the community. How does the system work in the USA, Australia, etc.? It's called advanced care planning. So it's a process to guide decision making about your healthcare if and when you do not have the capacity to decide for yourself. And as I said, by now you understood, it's got two major components. The proxy decision maker, which is your power of attorney for healthcare, which is your surrogate decision maker, and the guidance for that individual or individuals. So you have to tell them what type of life, what level of care, what you hope for once illness strikes. And all of this comes together in the living will. By now you understood that the crucial part of this is the conversation. The conversation that you must have with your family, the people you appoint as your healthcare power of attorney, your doctors, healthcare providers, and ideally, in the places where it is really well done, you have trained counselors who sit down with you and who make sure that everybody comes on the same page and that these documents are properly prepared. So this goes into your medical record, and then there is a system to act upon this. And it will be used when you lack capacity to be your own decision maker, because they provide guidance for your surrogates, your family, and your doctors. Now, as of now, if you do not put down a surrogate, then we look at these various level. I mean, it doesn't mean that if there is a spouse, or even if there is a partner with somebody who has been living and it is recognized as such, they have first priority over adult children, over parents, over siblings. Okay, so this is the sequence in which we accept instructions. But ideally, we prefer that all of them get together and give us a common decision. But as I said, for people outside conventional family structures, you actually need to appoint somebody. When do you do it? Well, we call these trigger events. A new diagnosis. Is a diagnosis of Parkinson's a new diagnosis? Yes, definitely. It's a diagnosis where you should think of it. Or if you get hospitalized in the later years in life, or if your care needs change, so you are doing well independently and you start needing a little bit of help. Somebody has to stand with you when you're shaving and things like that. That's when you start thinking about this. But the other point is anytime, because it always seems too soon until it is too late. So anytime. Would I do it? Would you do it for a young person? Yes. If you are worried about catastrophic brain injury. So for instance, somebody who's hit by a truck, a clot, a bullet, and becomes comatose or badly brain damaged. If that is something that bothers you, yes, then you need to make it at whatever age you are. If you come into your 60s and you've had a new diagnosis made, yes, then you need to start preparing. At least think of it. What happens if the illness goes badly? And especially if the illness is advanced, or you keep having to go to the doctor repeatedly. Or if somebody who's in the, basically anybody after a new diagnosis, or when the end is near. And this is something that doctors should be able to do. Experienced doctors can do it. You may have heard the story about a senior doctor who looks at a patient of his and tells the family quietly, yeah, I don't think he's going to be around. This is something that is an intuitive answer that an experienced doctor can give, and it has been shown to be valid. The problem is, in India, the experienced doctors, the family doctors who used to do this are few and far in between. How does this apply to Parkinson's? You can understand under the age of 60, Parkinson's is a different disease. In the ages of 60 to 75, it becomes more difficult. And over the age of 75, although people do fairly well with it, it can cause more and more problems. But typically, in addition to age, in fact, more than age, it is the stage. So somebody whose drug effect is fluctuating or incomplete, who's falling. More importantly, if you feel your mind is not as clear as before, or if you're requiring help with basic self-care, that is the time to get this document done. And as I said, if you change your mind, you can revoke it instantly, orally. I'll just share a small story. Remember, I showed you this picture of Atal Bihari. Atal Bihari passed away in August 2018. In April 2018, Barbara Bush died. In November 2018, George Bush died. Both Barbara and George Bush died in their own beds, surrounded by their family, literally like a darbar. How did they manage their last days so smoothly? Because they took charge and their system worked with them. Now, as I said, in India, this system does not exist. We have begun the process of doing it, and this happened because three Supreme Court judgments, literally within a year of each other. If you remember the preamble to the Constitution, justice, liberty, fraternity, equality, all of those, the liberty of that is the liberty of religious liberty and so on. But the liberty needs to be brought into the 21st century. It needed to be brought into privacy, into health autonomy, into sexual choice. And in health autonomy, the judgment that really did much of this constitutional sorting out is called the Common Cause Judgment. Unfortunately, it also prescribed procedures after that. And these procedures, as I said, are 40 years too late and 40 years out of date, because they apply only to terminal illness. They don't apply to, say, somebody who says, I don't want to live with brain damage. They have to be signed before a judicial magistrate first class. In the rest of the world, only one or two witnesses, with of course conditions, or a notary. Usually a notary is enough. In India, it has to be before the judicial magistrate first class. It has to be preserved in the district court. It has to be informed to the family. And there is no mention of enforceability. What if the doctor says, tears the paper up and says, I'm not going to follow this? What can you do? So this judgment made it difficult and did not make it enforceable. So we are in an uncertain situation where it is valid. But actually doing it, if you follow the Supreme Court process, is not very clear cut. So we are in an uncertain situation. You can either look on it as a glass that is half full or half empty. I'm an optimist. I think of it as a situation where it is my choice to do what I think is right. And the first choice is to start talking. Please start talking to your family. Begin by speaking to those close to you. Choose your surrogates. Confirm that they accept the responsibility. Confirm that they understand your wishes and that they will follow them even if they do not agree with them. Decide whether they can have any discretion or not, or they have to do what you say. Now, here it becomes a little tricky. So you may have surrogates, and one surrogate says, ha ha ha, yes, yes, yes. You've written that you will not, you don't want the ventilator and so on. You've written all of that, sure. So when you go into the ICU, I'll sign for it. Another surrogate says, no, 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 no. I don't care. I want you as long as you are there. It doesn't matter to me, even if you're on the ventilator, I will take care of you. This is number one. This is number three. Both of them, put them aside. You want somebody who says, yes, I hear you. I understand what you want. I will try my best to follow that. And I will try to be there for you. That is the person that you want. And then you make this advance medical directive, which has to be signed in front of two witnesses. And I suggest that we must try and get this in the presence of and attested by a judicial magistrate first class. One suggestion is maybe Sudhaji can make a group, find a lawyer, and do it together. I'm not sure how we will do it in these COVID times, but when that is over, we should be able to do it in person. Till then, I would suggest that we accept that it is not going to be possible to get the attestation by a JMFC. At least you can do the rest of it. As I said, in the rest of the world, one or two witnesses only are required, and if at all, a notary public. But the rest of the process, you can finish. Speaking, choosing, writing, signing, all of that you can do. Nobody is stopping you from doing that. Nobody is going to put you in jail for doing that. So do it. Then make multiple copies. Inform everybody. See that it goes into your health record. In fact, we suggest that you put it up on the fridge. Inform everybody who needs to know. and take it along if you have to be admitted for any procedure. But there is one more step that I am requesting you to do. Please show it to every doctor you consult. Why? You will find out if he or she is willing to accept it and will support you. They will find out if their hospital will accept it, so you know which hospital to go in an emergency, and the doctor will know your wishes. But more importantly, I need your help to make doctors understand how important this is. It's only when patients go with this that doctors will understand that this is as important as any of the latest medical technologies. I have been involved with this process since the beginning of this decade. I was part of the panel that examined Aruna Shanbag. A little while later, as I got more and more involved, we put together a task force. It's called End of Life Care in India Task Force. You may have seen it because intermittently we seem to appear in the press. And this is coming together of three sets of medical specialists, neurologists, ICU doctors, and palliative care doctors. But I would like to end with only one statement. Be the change you wish to see in this world. I don't need to tell you who said it. Thank you. My email ID is here. You're welcome to email me. But I suggest that let this discussion or whatever it is happen with Sudha ji, because we will need to coordinate this if we are really going to be taking any action. I'm ending at this point. Sudha ji,
sure.
Close? Thank you.
Yeah. So yeah, what I'll do is, that was great. I like your skiing picture in the end, Doctor. Very dynamic. Okay, so the thing is, everybody, please write down the questions that you have for Doctor in the chat box. எல்லாரும் எல்லாத்துக்கும் என்னென்ன கேள்வி இருக்கோ சாட் பாக்ஸ்ல எழுதுங்க. சார், நீங்க கையை தூக்குனா ஐ காண்ட் கிவ் யூ அன் ஆப்பர்ச்சுனிட்டி டு டாக் யெட் அன்லெஸ் வி ஹவ் எக்ஸாஸ்டட் ஆல் த க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ் ஃபர்ஸ்ட், தென் வில் டேக் அப் இஃப் தெர் இஸ் எனி திங் லெஃப்ட் டு பி ஆஸ்க், தென் வில் டேக் பர்சனல் க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ். ஸோ பட் ப்ளீஸ் ஸ்டார்ட் ரைட்டிங் யுவர் காமெண்ட்ஸ் ஆர் யுவர் க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ் டு டாக்டர். ஆஸ் யூ ஆர் டூயிங் தட், ஐ ஜஸ்ட் டேக் குவிக் 2 minutes, பிகாஸ் Doctor's whole talk was very relevant and each point was very significant. So I cannot possibly go through all the points in Tamil once again. So I'll just pick and choose a little bit of what I think can be relevant, something for you to think about. Okayla. So na kadagadan oru vaati ella Tamil la sollirren. Doctor ivlo nar enna English la sonnar. Sila perukku edhaachu sandhegam irundhathu, edhaachu oru edathila puriyala na ipo oru vaati sollirren. So advanced directives, adhaavadhu living will appdin sonnar doctor. நம்மளுக்கு சடனா உடம்பு சரியில்லாம போகுது, நம்மளால டெசிஷன் எடுக்க முடியறது இல்ல. நான் ஒரு ஸ்டோரியில இருந்து ஆரம்பிக்கிறேன், அதனால டக்குன்னு முடிச்சிடலாம். இப்போ நம்மளுக்கு வந்து லைஃப் சப்போர்ட்ல எவ்வளவு நேரம் இருக்கணும் இருக்கக்கூடாது, ஃபீடிங் டியூப்ல நம்ம சாப்பிடணுமா, ரொம்ப நாள் இருக்கணுமா வேண்டாமா, இதெல்லாம் கொஞ்சம் ரொம்ப டயாலிசிஸ் எத்தனை நாள் கண்டினியூ பண்ணலாம். நம்ம பரிவர்த்தன் மெம்பர்ஸ் நீங்க பாத்தீங்கன்னா, இஃப் ஐ டேக் அ சர்வே ஆஃப் பரிவர்த்தன் மெம்பர்ஸ் ஹூ பாஸ்ட் அவே ரீசென்ட்லி, more than 50% of them passed away in a hospital or in an ICU, unfortunately. So all doctor is trying to say is, everybody is going to end in death some point, the life is going to end at some point, but how is it going to end and where, which place is it going to end? எங்க நீங்க இறந்து போக போறீங்க, எப்படி இறந்து போக போறீங்கங்கற டயலாக் உங்க கையில இருக்கு. சோ நம்ம லைஃப் மட்டும் நம்ம கையில இல்ல, நம்ம கடைசி காலத்துல நம்மளுக்கு வந்து இறந்து போறது எப்படிங்கிறது கூட நம்ம தான் சார்ஜ் எடுத்துக்கணும். நம்ம ஃபேமிலி கூட சரௌண்டடா இருக்கணும், எந்த மாதிரி ட்ரீட்மெண்ட் நம்மளுக்கு நடக்கணும் நடக்க கூடாதுங்கிறது நம்ம கையில இருக்கு, அதை பத்தி இப்பிருந்தே யோசிக்கணும் அப்படின்னு டாக்டர் சொல்றாரு. ஓகேங்களா? ஃபார் டு கிவ் அ ஸ்மால் எக்ஸாம்பிள், நம்ம மெம்பர்ஸ் நிறைய பேருக்கு தெல் பி சம் எமர்ஜென்சி. பார்க்கின்சன்ஸ்ல தெல் ஆல்வேஸ் பி சம் எமர்ஜென்சி, தெல் பி அ ஃபால், தே வில் டெவலப் சம் ஆஸ்பிரேஷன், சம்திங் வில் ஹேப்பன். ஸோ வாட் எவ்ரிபடி வுட் திங்க், ஓ லெட்ஸ் ஜஸ்ட் கெட் தம் அட்மிட்டட் இன் த ஹாஸ்பிட்டல், முதல்ல ஆஸ்பத்திரிக்கு போயிடலாம், டாக்டர் என்ன சொல்றாங்கன்னு பார்க்கலாம். So that will be the immediate thing to do. Then what will happen is, once you go, you don't know when to stop it and come back home. அந்த ட்ரீட்மெண்ட் எவ்வளவு தூரம் ஒர்க் ஆகுது ஆகலன்னு கேஜ் பண்றதுக்கு ரொம்ப கஷ்டமா போய், சரி இன்னும் கொஞ்ச நாள் ஹாஸ்பிட்டல், இன்னும் கொஞ்ச நாள் ஹாஸ்பிட்டல்னு, பை த டைம் எனக்கோ ஸ்ரீகோ போன் வர்றதுக்குள்ளே த பேஷண்ட் இஸ் கான் ஆல்ரெடி, சாரி இங்க ஹாஸ்பிட்டலேயே இறந்துட்டாரு அப்படின்னு சொல்லுவாங்க. ஸோ அட் வாட் பாயிண்ட் டு யூ வாண்ட் டு, கேன் யூ அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் த ட்ரீட்மெண்ட் இஸ் நாட் ஒர்க்கிங் அண்ட் இட் இஸ் வெரி இம்பார்ட்டன்ட் ஜஸ்ட் டு ஸ்டே அட் ஹோம். ஸோ எங்க ஃபாதருக்கு ரொம்ப நாள் உடம்பு சரியில்லாம இருக்கல, அட் ஒன் பாயிண்ட் ஐ டிசைடட் கம் வாட் மே, நான் ஐசியூல போய் சேர்த்த மாட்டேன், என்னவா இருந்தாலும் வீட்லயே வச்சு பாத்துக்கலாம். சோ தட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் மேட் த டிசிஷன் மேக்கிங் ஈஸி ஃபார் மீ. ஐ டோன்ட் நோ அபௌட் மை ஃாதர். And then he passed away at home. So கீ திங்ஸ் டாக்டர் சொன்னதை வச்சு உங்களுக்கு வந்து எந்த மாதிரி ட்ரீட்மெண்ட் கொடுக்கணும், எங்க நீங்க இருக்க விருப்பப்படுறீங்க, எனக்கு வந்து ஐசியூல வென்டிலேட்டர்ல எனக்கு ரொம்ப நாள் இருக்க வேண்டாம், இவ்வளோ நான் இவ்வளோ ஸ்டேஜுக்கு மேலே போயிடுச்சுன்னா என்ன வீட்டுக்கு கூட்டிட்டு வா அப்படின்னு நீங்க முதலே டிசைட் பண்ணணும். இந்த டெசிஷன் மேக்கிங் அத்தாரிட்டி உங்களால டிசைட் பண்ண முடியல, நீங்களோ கான்சியஸ்னஸ் இல்லாம படுத்துட்டு இருக்கீங்க. இப்ப யாரு டிசைட் பண்ணுவா, அது அது அப்ப யாரு டிசைட் பண்ணுவாங்கிறது இப்ப நீங்க டிசைட் பண்ணணும். வழக்கமா யாருமே இல்லாட்டி ஸ்பவுஸ் டிசைட் பண்ண சொல்லுவாங்க டாக்டர் சொல்றாரு. ஸோ ஹஸ்பண்டோ ஒய்ஃபோ சம்படி வில் டேக் த கால். சில சமயம் அது முடியல, ஃபார் சம் அன்ஃபார்ச்சுனேட் ரீசன் தெர் இஸ் நோ ஸ்பவுஸ்னு வச்சுக்கோங்க. அப்ப குழந்தைங்க, இப்ப ரெண்டு மூணு குழந்தைங்க இருக்காங்க, சில பேர் யூஎஸ்ல இருக்காங்க, சில பேர் இந்தியாவில் இருக்காங்க, நான் அதுல யார் டிசிஷன் எடுப்பாங்க? ஸோ யார் டிசிஷன் எடுப்பான்னு ஒரு மூணு பேர்த்து சூஸ் பண்ணுங்க அப்படின்னு சொல்றாரு. த்ரீ ஆர்டர்ல சூஸ் பண்ணுங்க, அப்புறம் ஒரு பேனல் ஆஃப் மூணு டாக்டர்ஸ் சூஸ் பண்ணுங்க. இந்த டாக்டர் வந்து எங்களோட பிரைமரி டாக்டர், எங்க பார்க்கின்சன்ஸ் டாக்டர் ஒருத்தர், ஒரு ஜென்ரல் பிசிஷியன் மாதிரி ஒரு மூணு டாக்டர் நீங்க வச்சுக்கோங்க. ஸோ தே வில் பி ஏபிள் டு டேக் த கால். அப்புறம் நீங்க டிசைட் பண்ணுங்க, நான் ரயில் டியூப்லயே இருந்தாகணும்னா நான் இருக்க விருப்பப்படுறேனா இல்லையா. சரி, எமர்ஜென்சிக்கு வென்டிலேட்டர் வச்சிடறோம், எத்தனை நாள் நான் வென்டிலேட்டர் சப்போர்ட்ல இருக்கிறது, இத்தனை நாளைக்கு மேல போச்சு நான் ரெஸ்பாண்ட் பண்ணாட்டி வென்டிலேட்டர் சப்போர்ட் எடுத்துருங்க அப்படின்னு நீங்க முதலே சொல்லிடணும். டயாலிசிஸ் கொடுங்க, பட் இதுக்கு மேல ஒர்க் ஆகாட்டி நிறுத்திடுங்க. இதெல்லாம் ரொம்ப டஃப்பான கான்வர்சேஷன்ஸ். என்னால சுத்தமா, ஐ டோன்ட் நோ எங்க அப்பா என்ன சொல்லியிருப்பாங்கன்னு எனக்கு தெரியல, என்னால சுத்தமா நடக்க முடியல, பேச முடியல, கம்யூனிகேட் பண்ண முடியல, அப்படி இருந்தா என்ன நீ உயிரோட வச்சிருக்காத அப்படின்னு சொன்னாலும் சொல்லியிருந்திருக்கலாம் எங்க அப்பா. ஆனாலும் அப்படியே நாங்க ஒரு ஃபோர் இயர்ஸ் அப்பாவை மெயின்டைன் பண்ணிட்டு இருந்தோம். ஸோ ஐ டோன்ட் நோ வாட் இஸ் ப்ரிஃபரன்சஸ் வர இல்லைங்களா, அது முதல்லயே டிசைட் பண்ணிட்டேன். இப்ப நான் அம்மாவை கிளியரா கேட்டுட்டேன், உனக்கு எவ்வளவு தூரம் போனா போகலாம் வேண்டாம் அப்படின்னு. ஸோ இந்த மாதிரி டஃப் டிசிஷன்ஸ் மேக் அ சாய்ஸ் பிஃபோர். ஸோ நம்பர் ஒன், யார் உங்களுக்கு டிசிஷன் மேக்கிங் அத்தாரிட்டி, மூணு பேர்த்த சூஸ் பண்ணுங்க, எங்க விருப்பப்படுறீங்க, எவ்வளவு அளவுக்கு ட்ரீட்மெண்ட் போகணும் போக கூடாது அது டிசைட் பண்ணுங்க. இது வந்து நம்ம இந்தியாவில வந்து ஒரு 30-40 வருஷம் தள்ளி இருக்கும் வெஸ்டர்ன் கண்ட்ரீஸை விட, அங்கெல்லாம் லீகலி இதெல்லாம் ஏற்கனவே ஸ்ட்ரக்சரா போட்டாச்சு அப்படின்னு சொல்றாரு டாக்டர். ஸோ நம்ம இப்போ கொஞ்சம் காம்ப்ளிகேட்டடா இருக்கு இந்தியாவில, இதெல்லாம் எழுதிட்டு நம்ம வந்து ஜுடிஷியல் மேஜிஸ்ட்ரேட் கிளாஸ் 1 அப்படின்னு அவங்க கிட்ட போய் சைன் வாங்கணுமா, இது அது வாங்கி அதுக்கப்புறம் அதெல்லாம் அட்டஸ்ட் பண்ணி அதோட இடத்துல வச்சுக்கணும்னு சொல்றாரு. இது ரொம்ப காம்ப்ளிகேட்டடா இருக்கு, இப்ப நம்மளால இதெல்லாம் பண்ண முடியாது. ஸோ நம்மளால இப்ப என்ன பண்ண முடியும், யாரு நம்மளுக்கு டிசைடிங் அத்தாரிட்டி, என்னெல்லாம் டிசைட் பண்ணணும், என்னோட விருப்பம் என்ன, இதெல்லாம் நீங்க அட்லீஸ்ட் டிசைட் பண்ணி ஒரு பேப்பர்ல எழுதி வச்சுக்கோங்க. இதுக்கு ரெண்டு விட்னஸ் தேவை அப்படின்னு சொல்றாரு டாக்டர். அட்லீஸ்ட் அதை ரெடி பண்ணி வைங்க, பண்ணி வச்சு நிறைய காப்பீஸ் எடுத்து வச்சுக்கோங்க. கீப் இட் இன் யோர் ஹவுஸ், அவர் ஃப்ரிட்ஜ்ல கூட வச்சுக்கோங்க, ஃப்ரிட்ஜ் மேல கூட அப்படி மேக்னெட் போட்டு ஒட்டி வைங்க. லெட் எவ்ரிபடி நோ வாட் இஸ் ட்ரைங் டு சேஸ், எல்லாத்துக்கும் இதை பத்தி சொல்லுங்க, குழந்தைகிட்ட சொல்லுங்க, ஸ்பவுஸ் கிட்ட சொல்லுங்க, சிப்ளிங்ஸ் கிட்ட சொல்லுங்க, இம்மீடியட் ஃபேமிலி எல்லாத்துக்கிட்ட இந்த மாதிரி நான் பண்ணிருக்கேன் இந்த மாதிரி நான் யோசிச்சிருக்கேன்னு சொல்லுங்க. அப்புறம் ஒவ்வொரு வாட்டியும் அவங்களோட பிரைமரி டாக்டர் கிட்ட போகல அதை காட்டுங்க, திஸ் இஸ் மை சாய்ஸ், இதுதான் நான் விருப்பப்படுறேன், ஸோ ஐ வாண்ட் டு ஆக்ட் ஆன் திஸ் அப்படின்னு அவங்க கிட்ட சொல்லிட்டே இருங்க நீங்க. ஸோ சப்போஸ் நாளைக்கு ஒரு எமர்ஜென்சின்னு வந்ததுன்னா தென் தே வில் பி ஏபிள் டு டேக் அ கால். ஏன்னா திருப்பி 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 நான் பரிவர்த்தனில் கேட்கிற ஸ்டோரியும் இதுதான், மெம்பர்ஸ் சொல்றதும் இதுதான், எமர்ஜென்சின்னு ஹாஸ்பிட்டல் அட்மிட் பண்ணோம், ஹாஸ்பிட்டலே இறந்துட்டாருமா, ஐசியூலயே போயிட்டாருமா. இட் இஸ் ரியலி சேட் டு ஹியர் தட் தே வர் நாட் சரௌண்டட் பை தேர் ஃபேமிலி, பை தேர் லவ்ட் ஒன்ஸ், தே டிடன்ட் கெட் டு சீ தெம், தட் பர்சன் டிடன்ட் இவன் நோ வாட் வாஸ் பீங் டன் ஃபார் தெம். So these are all very unfortunate circumstances. இது நம்ம நிறைய டு அ லார்ஜ் எக்ஸ்டென்ட் இந்த ஒரு மன வருத்தத்தை நம்ம அவாய்ட் பண்ணலாம் அப்படின்னு டாக்டர் சொல்றாரு. Now, let me see what questions are there. This is a brief recap. Of course, we cannot go completely into details. Let me see. There are quite a few questions. Hold on, doctor. I'm trying to see from the beginning.
The chat? I looked at the chat.
Not coming. Okay. Okay, so for multiple end of life care, it becomes even more difficult if they have to execute. So Dr. Satyendra Singh is saying it becomes very difficult. It's a three-tier process that the apex court has put in place for withholding or withdrawing life-sustaining treatments. It involves multiple boards which make end of life care process romba cumbersome. So it becomes even more difficult for people with disability even if they have executed like an advanced living care is what Dr. Satyendra Singh is saying. I don't think it is a question, but he's just saying for people with difficulty how disability, what a big problem that is.
Can I just add a point here? See, so if you look at the Supreme Court judgment, they have discussed withdrawal. So for instance, somebody lands up in the ICU and they are on a ventilator, then this process of disconnecting, if you have to do it by the Supreme Court procedure, is next to impossible. To my knowledge, it has that process has not been used anywhere in the country. ideally, the solution is withholding, not withdrawal, withholding. Exactly. So before that, so if this conversation is held, and let me assure you, being put on a ventilator, being having a tube inserted, there will be people who will go through this experience because of COVID. And you can ask them, nobody, it is horrible. It is horrible. And especially if you are at the end of life and you want everything to be in peace, nobody wants that. So the best way to handle that is withholding. Make it very clear, this is what I do not want. And we can do that because the ICMR, the DNAR document that I was a part of, very clearly says that you can say that I do not want resuscitation. I do not want all these things done to me. And ideally, and this applies for people with severe Parkinson's, if you are, and Sudhaji and I will discuss this, if we can identify people from the palliative care space who are willing to assist people with Parkinson's, then way in advance, it would be good for you to connect with them so that together with your palliative care doctor, you also have, with your Parkinson's doctor, you also have a palliative care physician who starts, the two start to work together. It is not as though the Parkinson's doctor stops and says, now you take over. No, that is not the way it is supposed to be. Ideally, I know, but there are going to be more of us, people who are both neurologists as well as trained in palliative care. But till then, you will have to use the team to work together.
Yeah.
And it will be important, and I think Sudhaji is the right person to do this, for Chennai at least, is to start making these teams possible. Yeah.
It is very important. Thank you, Dr. Singh, for bringing that up. There is one question from a member's daughter. Her father has advanced Parkinson's plus. So she's saying he's already quite advanced. And it is very, how do we now get answers from him? How do we know what he feels? He's unable to write. He's unable to communicate. My mom is making all the decisions. So how do we go about with him is what she's asking, to prepare something like this.
Okay. So there, this is something that happens even in dementia. Now, you do need a neurologist or maybe even a psychologist to make this assessment. And till up to the point, I mean, we have staging for dementia that also to some extent applies to Parkinson's. People may not be able to make very detailed discussions, but some basic solutions like, who do you want to decide these things? That can be asked. That can be asked till the last, I mean, till somebody becomes completely inarticulate. Who do you want to make these decisions? And you may be surprised. The person may be very clear about who they want to make these decisions. That's one. The second is, it takes a little bit of time and effort. And you can discuss this, that if things get worse, I wish it does not happen, but if it does happen, do you have any thoughts? Do you want to tell us anything about this? And obviously with somebody like that, this is not an answer that is going to come instantly. It will take time. But their wishes, and it's important. It's important because even in that stage, you are giving him the respect that he is entitled or she is entitled to. That respect of asking them, what do you want? What is important to you? Exactly. And if he says, whatever it is, I want to be here, accept it.
Beautiful, doctor. Because in the first presentation I heard doctor make in Kerala, the one sentence that stuck to my head was, as a caregiver, you will always remember how the person died. It's not... Because the suffering or illness you won't remember, but the last minute how they died is something we'll always remember. The person who's died has gone, but what stays in our minds is how they have passed away. So it's as much for them as much it is for us. So Kavita, what I would say, as doctor said, is one thing is you can try and coax Appa into communicating a little bit, If not you, your siblings and your mom should have this conversation amongst yourself to decide how you will go forward with it. Like when my father couldn't make any decision, then I had to take a call on, okay, tomorrow if there is an emergency, what am I going to do? So it is important that you as a caregiver be prepared as to what you are going to do. And like doctor said, nobody wants to die in a hospital or in an ICU with all tubes in there. So this is something for you to keep in mind. Sameer Sethi is saying, please speak in English. Sir, I was only reiterating what doctor said in Tamil because a large section of our members are exclusively Tamil speaking. Sorry for that. But I didn't say anything that you didn't hear from doctor. And Dr. Shubhadra is asking, she's saying, number one, very good presentation. And she also wants to know how many of your patients, like what's the percentage who have prepared an advanced care?
No, it's... I'm waiting to see the first one come to me with her advanced care planning. This is my... When that happens, I will...
Yeah, your job is like going to the right track. Yeah, I know. Yeah. So Priya is saying, our family trusts doctors so much and thinks they can fix any medical issue. Not going to the doctor is unthinkable. When will we know we are at the right point of no return? When we can stop treatment and go home. So this is a very valid question, I think. When would we know that this is it? Now, you can't, the doctors could say something, but when are we going to stop this? When do we know it is enough? I think this happens with Parkinson's a lot, on most disabilities, I'm sure.
I think, go back through the process that I said, sort out your own mind.
Yeah.
You cannot, I'm sorry, I am a doctor. But I don't want this responsibility. I don't want to be responsible for these choices. I want you. If at all, I'm willing to talk with you on how these choices have to be made. But to put it on me is not right. I mean, some people will do that. I understand that. And people do that all the time, even today. But to me, you will hear of doctors who say, I get very irritated when people come with Google and all that. But I think those of us who are, we have to proceed to the point where we are partners. I as your doctor and you as the master of your own body and your own illness, we will partner together. We will try and work out what you would want. But this job of thinking this through, no. This is something, once you have thought this through, then you can show it to the doctor and then the doctor can tell you, okay, this is what is likely to happen to you. This is what we should watch out for. When you cross this stage, then this is what we will think of. Now that, I think... you will have to, you will need to make sure your doctor also is willing to walk the same path.
Exactly. I think it's very important, as doctor says, is to start having these conversations now with family, with your primary Parkinson's neurologist, constantly have this talk. And there are only, as far as I have seen in the last 6 years, only 3 or 4 trajectories that happen with this disorder. I'm sure for people joining us from other spheres, the trajectories are almost the same. There's an aspirational pneumonia, there is like a fracture, there is like a dehydration that they develop. You know, so there are few things that happen typically. So after a point, it's very important for us as a community in Parivartan to keep discussing these issues over and over so we know what is happening with every member so we can be prepared when something happens in our families. So Mr. Venkateshan is saying, I want to be surrounded by my family and I want my death to be natural at home and I don't want it to be in a hospital. Definitely, sir. I think most people prefer that. That's why doctor is saying precisely put this all in paper, put this all in writing and communicate this to everybody. That's precisely what he's saying. Doctor, do you want to say something for that?
No, I agree. I mean, that is perfectly complete. Yeah. Somebody said cryonic facility anyway. So.
Okay. Mitra Madam from Calcutta is saying this was a very informative session. And she's asked her members in her group to start making decisions before it becomes too late. Really, thank you, Mitraji, for joining us. Extremely good session. Everything crystal clear. help decision making very easy. Okay, that was a good feedback from Meena Gupta. Yeah, so again, the same question. Mr. Shankar Narayanan is a big fan of yours. He's attended your sessions before in palliative care groups. And he again wants to know how many people in India have executed advanced directives?
Now, apparently only one.
Oh,
1.2 billion people only, not one, one couple. So one couple, this couple is in Chandigarh. Okay. This came out in the Indian Express. So if you look it up, it's there. And they actually went to the district court, made the district judge pass an order which forced the judicial magistrate first class to countersign.
Wow.
But the gentleman who did it
happens
to have been a very senior professor of the law university, of the law department of Punjab University.
So there is an edge. So, he knows his way around. Okay.
Yeah, so
law also makes it very difficult. I think if it was something like how doctor said, prepare it and two people have to just sign it, get it attested by a notary, then I think a lot of people would actually do it. At least many more than what it is right now do it. That I think because of this element of district judge coming in, magistrate, I think the process is so complicated, people are like, you know what, not for us. Smita is asking
But I would like to again reiterate that point. Then nobody is going to put you in jail if you make it.
Exactly. It'll make your life.
I don't understand. I mean, what is it, who is it meant for? It is meant for your family and for yourself.
Yeah.
If it is meant for you and your family, then where does the doctors, the judges, everybody comes after that.
Right.
Even the doctors come after that. So first it is you and your family. You sort it out.
Absolutely.
Once you've sorted it out and it's reasonably clear, and your family is completely on board, no doctor is going to say no to it.
True. And unfortunately or fortunately, everybody in this gathering today has something to do with illness. Either your practitioners, your medical practitioners or caregivers or people who are affected by some disorder. But what about this other general population who are just sitting and thinking nothing is going to happen to me? And there'll be a wake-up call one day and everybody will be scrambling to get answers. So, you know, the word needs to go out to everybody in the public, according to me, not just us who work in the field. Anyway, let's take the next question by Smita. She's asking, what is the support system available for poor people to carry out advanced directives and have life support or other support at home, as everything costs a lot?
Let's put it this way. And this is something that we have really thought about quite a bit. You know, this is a kind of social innovation. And like it or not, social innovation is carried out by the middle class. I wish this is something that is available to everyone. But I mean, until I look at it this way, until the last person in the line does it, will I stop the ones ahead in the line from doing it? No, I will not. So I think let's look on this as an individual responsibility rather than it's we as individuals who make up the nation. So let us do it as individuals.
But Smita, to answer your question, I have an unfortunately a very saddening reality, which sounds very crude if I say, people who really don't have the financial means also don't have much of a choice. So in some ways, they are not prolonging their suffering as much as people who have the financial wherewithal to be in life support system for longer than needed. Unfortunately, people who don't have monetary support do not get life-saving support on one hand to live. And sometimes, unfortunately, rightly, they don't get support. And so hence, they pass away also quickly. And in between all this, quality of life always takes